said we are ready. And you have a worship sheet. We are going to be singing a congregational selection of Have Thine Own Way, Lord. Amen. But while we're getting started, I am certainly encouraged by the fact that God is still doing what he's always done. And you say, well, what are you talking about? These things that we call calamities are his works of his own being. And so, as a result, I hate it for those in the area, but I know they were there before anybody ever lived, in before there was a New Orleans or Baton Rouge or Pensacola, Florida. But I pray for those who are inhabitants there, and that they will, the Lord will bless and sustain them. All right, if we got a screen, Brother Germany, we're going to open up our selection, open up with the selection, Have Thine Own Way. Let's stand together.
Good morning, congregation. The word says, make a joyful noise.
Amen.
Unto the Lord, all ye land.
Amen. Amen.
Please help me.
Amen. Brother Green, I say that for him to do it himself. Amen. And let us know how he felt about our choir duties. Amen. Our scripture reading is coming from Romans, the 5th chapter, verse 1. Romans chapter 5. Together. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And all that, you may be seated. Let's bow together. Gracious Lord, we adore you and we extol your goodness for allowing us this opportunity to come together in worship, in spirit and in truth. Oh, gracious Lord, will you receive our worship as from your servants? For we know you are the only one worthy, worthy, worthy of all our praise. We give you glory, we give you honor, and we acknowledge you as our God, the Father of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And we ask that you would continue to be thy shield, our strength, and our shield. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. And may we all say, amen. God bless you and may God keep you. Our announcements, my brothers and sisters, is that we want to continue to pray for our youth. And as they are, I think I just want everyone now is in school. And so, all the districts, rather. And so let us be in prayer because these are, as you well know, tedious times. Amen. And the hospitalization rates across the nation are creeping up vastly with young people. Amen. So let us be in prayer. The Gideon that usually comes and be with us in September. Last year, because of the pandemic, that was postponed. But this year, we will have a Gideon representative come and speak with us and share with us what the Gideon are doing on the 12th, I believe, on the second Sunday. And I don't know who, but Bo Rester is the lead person for the community for this area, and so there will either he or he will be sending someone, and you know we had them from Paris or from Atlanta, but we have always been partners with the Gideon, and I was listening to our honorable judge on the other day, and our hospital is full. And the hospital in Pittsburgh is full. And the thing for us to do is to be vigilant, to be obedient, and to be prayerful. Amen. Because we don't know, I guess someone said we're in the third wave, or whichever wave. I just believe that the Lord is going to bring us through just like he has before now. So, but we have to, when he gives you the information, all you have to do is follow it. Amen. And so that's what we want to do. Encourage anyone you know that has not received their shot, their vaccination. Encourage them to do so. All right? Just encourage them. You can't make anybody do anything, but just encourage them. Let us be mindful of those in the hurricane zone, prayerful for them. Let us also be mindful of the evacuees from the military, all of our troops, and those that have lost their lives this week, those 13 valiant, honorable persons who gave their life in support of our freedom. Amen. And no politics. Death is death regardless of what the situation is. And those families are at loss. So let us remember them in our prayers, all right? And may the Lord bless and keep you. Our selection, Brother Green is going to bless us with it. And now we got to pay attention because like he does, that's what he wants us to do. Amen? All right. you, Brother Green. Amen. Lift them up through our praise. Lift them up through our witness. Lift them up through our lives. Amen. It's responsive reading time, and we are going to be reading from the book of James. Amen. James chapter 2, verses 14 through 18. So if you will stand, and let us keep your mind on what James is saying. But we're going to talk about this a little further. If you have it, let's begin, shall we? What doth it profit, my brethren, though a man say he hath faith and have not works? Can faith save him? If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you say unto them, depart in peace, be ye warm and feed, notwithstanding ye give them not those things which are needful to the body, what doth it profit? Even so, if it hath not worked, is dead, being alone. Yea, a man may say, thou hast faith, and I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works, and I will show thee my faith by my works. Amen. May God add a blessing on the readers, hearers, and doers of his word. As we close the world out and close in our thought of the Lord for our altar prayer, I'm going to point out, make you aware of some things. Sister Sue, I am informed, over 20 years ago, the Lord blessed her to have tumor removed from your brain or cranial area 20 years ago. Today, 20 years today. Isn't God somebody? Well, what a blessing. And she's here, and we know that God is certainly dealing greatly with her, you know, all the beautiful things that she does and carries forth in his name. What a powerful, powerful testimony. Also remember Brother Turner, Brother George Turner, he is recuperating. I don't know if he has been released, but I spoke with him personally by phone the other day, and he was very encouraging. He looked like he said it was touch and go for him, but now he feels like he's on his way. Sister Elisa Turner has been in the Tyler Hospital for some time, at least 2 to 3 weeks, with pneumonia, but she's out and at home. And she texted me and said, make sure you remind them that I said thank you for your prayers. And also she wanted to know where could we she get the service this morning. She is home and doing well. Pray for Sister Betty Norman. Amen. Sister Norman she has been in quarantine, but she's doing well, to my knowledge, and God is blessed. Now, as I aforementioned, those that are in the hurricane zone, those that are in the war zone of Afghanistan, those parents who have lost their loved one, and we as a country, amen, and our government, our president, all the way down, all the military leaders, just so those who are being evacuated can do so from this point on safely. Let's bow together. Gracious Lord, our Father, we call upon you because we know you are the only source. You are the first cause. Everything else that has happened started from you. And we know that you and you alone rule and super rule this universe. For as the psalmist said, the earth is the Lord, and the fullness thereof, and they that dwell therein. So Lord God Almighty, we come with humble hearts and our heads about, because we know that everything we desire of righteousness has to proceed from you. Now, Lord, you know what's on our heart. You know that we are still in a pandemic, and you know that it seems to be increasing on every hand, but nothing is beyond you. And I want to say thank you, Lord. Nothing gets beyond you. Nothing can get away from you. And so we place our hand in your hand. You shall bring us through. And Father God, as we have been speaking, those that are in southern Louisiana and along the Gulf Coast that's being faced right now with this tremendous hurricane, Lord, spare their lives. We know that these things were going to bring damage, but spare lives, Lord. Bless them, and may they be able to come through, Lord, with your hand of mercy. Those that are in the hospital that have COVID and all other things and cannot be transferred. Louisiana, one of the heaviest states of COVID. It would seem like when it rains, it pours. But we know that you are just God. We all belong to you. And whatever you decree and decry, we know it is righteous all together. So comfort ye my people, Isaiah said. Comfort ye my people in this nation. Whatever they're going through, have them know that the comfort of the Almighty God is at our disposal if we would trust in you. Trust in your son, Jesus. He will guide us through. Now, Master, you know that on this past Thursday, 13 valiant soldiers lost their lives because of a suicide bomb in Afghanistan. And the mothers and fathers, wives and brothers and sisters back home, Lord, they need your comfort. But we thank you for those gallant men and women. And we thank you for our military throughout this world. Put your arm of protection around. Oh, Lord God Almighty, those families can't have their loved ones replaced, but they can realize that the one who made their loved ones is still right there for them. And let those of us who are citizens being recipients of their valentry, let us not forget. Now, Lord, here in Mount Pleasant, bless us, Lord. Lift us up. Many are still weary over the condition we're in. But teach men to study thy ways in you, and that you would relieve their anxieties, calm their fears, take away their despair. For there's joy in serving the true and living God. in the name of Jesus. Bless your word today, and may it go forth and touch hearts and guide men, that if someone is not, hasn't accepted your son as their Savior, they may do so this day. In the name of Jesus, in the powerful name, in the only begotten Son's name, we pray. And for thy sake, let us all say, amen. Glory to God. The hymn of the morning, pass me not. We want to blow the top off, because we don't want to be passed. Amen. Let's stand. Pass me not, O gentle saint. Hear my humble cry. While on others thou art talking. O Lord, please, 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 please. Don't. Oh, yes. Everybody. When I hear that, in my mind, I see Jesus walking down the street, and I feel like I'm like the woman with the issue of blood who was pleading. If I could just touch the hem of his garment, all these others around him, thronging him, but if I could just touch, please don't pass me. We ought to have our hands outreached, trying to catch a hold of it. Amen. Don't pass me by. Thank you, Brother Green. Thank you, congregation, on this Lord's Day. Our lesson this morning, and that's what it is, a lesson this morning, I'm choosing another doctrinal type of message. Amen. And the subject is faith and works. And if you know anything about faith and works, then you'll realize why I chose two passages of Scripture. Because there's several others that could be used. Two different authors. Romans by Paul, James the pastor, Pastor James. Those scriptures, and if you have them, screen, we will look at them. The one, Romans 5:1 says, therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Then James says, even so, if it has not worked, even so, faith, if it has not works, is dead. Being alone. Now, my brothers and sisters, there has been an age-old discussion, maybe a few arguments or two, on whether or not faith alone will save you, or whether faith or whether works alone will save you. Well, the Apostle Paul, approaches salvation by faith. That's why he wrote that. Therefore, being justified by faith. And there in the introduction, Pastor James, and you want to know why I call him Pastor James, because he's the half-brother of Jesus. When you open the book of James, you are reading what the half-brother of Jesus. This is not James, the disciple who was John's brother. This is the leader of the Jerusalem church after Pentecost, where we are in the book of Acts now. We're on down the road, but shortly after the day of Pentecost and the church was born, so to speak, the Jerusalem congregation was pastored by James. And he is writing this portion, even so, if it has not worked, faith, if it has not worked, it's dead, being alone. And so my question is to you, I want you, as we go through this, my question is this a contradiction or is it complementary? Is it a contradiction or is it Let's look at Paul's view. Paul's view was, if we'll go to our first part of the outline, Paul's view was faith alone justifies. Faith alone justifies. And you said, now what do you mean by justifies? Well, the doctrine of justification, and I can't go into, I don't have time to go into depths of justification. But justification means to be declared or accredited or imputed to be righteous or just. What do you mean? Let me give you an illustration. In the early centuries, Ovid tells us from the epic writings of the Greek and the Roman. Ovid tells us that if a person in the early culture was deemed a criminal and was brought to before a tribunal of judges, and after they heard all of the testimonies and looked through all the evidence, then upon hearing, if they thought the individual was innocent of justice, they would take white stone, and the white stone would be put in a urn. If they thought the individual was guilty and condemnable, they would put black stone in the urn. Now, placing the white stone or the black stone in the urn didn't make the person any more innocent or guilty. But for the case of the individual, he was declared, y'all be hear what I say, he was declared innocent or guilty by their placing the stones. He could have been just as guilty as ever, but if they thought he was innocent, and that's how justification is. Listen, we will never be able, there's no way we can be justified unless God declared us so. Somebody ought to help me. Yeah, because justification means that you are just and you are righteous altogether. Well, if according to what Paul tells us, that if you are righteous, then that means you never have been a sinner. Oh, glory. And where are you going to find anybody that's not a sinner? Paul tells us as he talks about this in Romans 4:1 through Romans 5, he talks about how in the world, where are you going to find a sinless person, because the law was given to Moses, and it was given for us to realize that none of us could keep it. Because if you break one, and James will say this too in the last, if you break one, you just as well have broken them all. You are guilty. But then Paul comes along after showing us that, he comes along and said, now how are we justified? We are justified by faith. And he uses Father Abraham as an example. Help me, Lord Jesus. Yeah. In Galatians 3 and 6, he said, and Abraham believed God, and God imputed it, accounted it, credited it, so to speak, to him for righteousness. So he then comes to the conclusion in Romans 5:1. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God, am I anywhere? Through Christ Jesus. You are declared just with God when you believe that his son, Jesus, his son is the Lord, is Jesus the Christ. And he died for our sins and was raised on the third day. That justifies you. That takes care of all of that sin. Somebody ought to help me here. So you say, well, if faith is all I need, then I'm going to stop right there. I believe. I believe. So I'm saying, well, yes. But James comes through with another view. And he's looking, as Paul was looking this way toward faith, James is looking this way toward works. Am I anywhere? Because James says to us this. He says, now, wait a minute. If there's no works, no faith. Now, wait, what is James talking about, works? When you open the book of James, it's easy for you all to be able to see that he is a doer man. He is a man of doing. He is a man of righteous acts. Works are righteous acts. Works are things like I'm preaching. That's works. Preaching is works for works of righteousness. But my preaching's not going to save me. Y'all didn't hear what I said. No, going to church every Sunday and serving on the mission, the Usher board, brother Germany back there on the control, that's not gonna save him. That's works. That's good, and I'm glad he's back there. You being here every Sunday, oh, I love it. That's works. Getting up to the old home and coming here, that's works. Going and visiting the sick at the hospital, when even though we can't now, and the nursing home, and putting clothes on the backs of others, that's works. That's what James is saying. How can you say that you have faith and somebody comes to you naked and hungry and you tell them, oh, I'm satisfied. James is saying that if you got faith, you don't go around with your hand down in your pocket and just come out. James is a faith works. He's a works man. Because he says true faith ought to produce works. Somebody ought to help me. Notice, if you will. Let's go back down to response to reading. He says, James says, what doth it profit, my brethren? Though a man say he has faith and have not works, can faith save him? And then he goes on down in verse 16, and if one of you say unto the other, depart in peace, be warm, snow is on the ground, they don't have any shoes, nothing on their back. Notwithstanding, ye give them not these things which are needful for the body. What doth it profit? And when you really get down to it, my brothers and sisters, faith must produce works. Because you're saved, or let me put it this way, one of the great writers wrote, said, faith alone will save you. But saving faith is never alone. That's why these people say, and I hesitate, but I got something about to say. That's why these people, you know, there is no commitment. If you watch me on TV while you got two pillows behind your head, excuse the expression, just lying there, no commitment. That's good if you're sick or so on and so forth. But if you have faith, you ought to want to be among the people of faith. Somebody ought to help me here. That's why the Hebrew writer said, forsake not the assembling of yourself together. But don't you know, my brothers and sisters, if faith is in your body, it's going to cause you to do something. Both of them, James and Paul, used Abraham as the example. Paul used it from the example that faith justified him, and it did. But then James came along after that and said, not only did faith faith justify, but James said, look, Abraham didn't just believe and stop. No. It was Abraham that got his only begotten, only son, Isaac, and went up to Mount Moriah to offer him as a sacrifice unto God. He said that's works. And that works was placed there because Abraham believed God. In Joshua, and I'm closing now, in Joshua chapter 2, yeah, he goes on to mention another. In Joshua, and I'm speaking of this, this is all in James, the second chapter. This second chapter is the chapter of faith and works in James. Amen. 3 through 5 of Romans is faith, if you want to put it down like that. Paul gets on it in chapter 3, telling us that we are all sinners, and then he goes to show us how we're justified. All right? That's chapters 3 through 5 of Romans. But now, back to James. James goes on down in verse 23 and 24 and those lower verses of chapter 2 and tells us about Abraham. But then he brings up another person. He brings up Rahab. You remember Rahab, don't you? Well, let me just remind you a little bit. I know this, I'm not going to charge y'all anything extra for this. Rahab was a prostitute in Jericho when Joshua was getting ready to cross the Jordan to go in and take the land of Canaan. And he sent out 2 spies. Are y'all with me? Yeah. This is in Joshua chapter 2. He sent out 2 spies, and the 2 spies went into Jericho and to keep, as they were being pursued, this lady, Rahab, put them up and sheltered them and told the king of Jericho that they were gone. Because he had sent me and he learned about them being in the city. And he had sent men to find them. Am I anywhere? Yeah. And she hid them, but she told him, said, now look, I've heard about you all. I heard what you all did, you Israelites. I heard what you all did to the Amorites. And I know that the God you serve, somebody ought to help me. I know that the God you serve is a powerful God. And I'm a Canaanite. I'm living in a paganistic world, but I know what your God can do. You got to make me a promise. You got to give me a token that when you all come in, when you come in and take this place, take this city, spare me, spare my mother, my father, and all my household. Somebody ought to help me here. Yeah. And I believe God. I believe your God. I don't know him, but I believe him. But what I want you to do is perform some works and take care of us. To the camp of the Israelites, they told Joshua, said, look, when we go in there. There was a lady there. Yeah, she still had a bad reputation, but there was a lady there who spared our lives. Yeah. We got to remember. I mean, that's what works does. Faith in God will produce works. And Rahab was saved not only because she believed God, but because she provided a place so that when the Israelites came into Jericho, we're going to tear down every house except Rahab. Glory, hallelujah. Let me tell you something, my brothers and sisters. Faith and works are complementary, not complementary. I mean, complementary, not complementary. Complementary. One is completed with the other. Sure. Sam, I can give you X number of examples of how salvation can happen and you don't get a chance to do any works. How about the thief on the cross? Oh, help me, Holy Ghost. That's what most of them will say. Well, you know, that thief, Jesus said, today you would be with me in paradise. Yeah, but he didn't get a chance to go to church, and he didn't get a chance to be on the usher board, and he didn't get a chance to pay his tithes and all those things. But all my brothers and my sisters, don't you know faith? That faith saved him. But I believe if he was able to get out off of that cross, can I get a witness? He would have walked on and told me how grateful he was that Jesus had saved him. In summary, faith alone saves. Faith through Jesus Christ will save you. By grace through faith, Ephesians 2:8, are we saved? But then works will follow faith. I hear Paul saying to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. He's talking about if whoever works abide at judgment time. Yeah. If you do works of straw, basically, of silver and of gold, what he's saying is that at the time of judgment, our Sunday school lesson just told us, at the time of judgment, the Lord will give you your righteousness. He'll judge and give you your reward based on what you've done in this life. Can I get a witness? Yeah. You know what? I know I can't get what Paul got, but I can get what Kurt Roberts can have. Yeah, and you can get what you can have. Yeah, by simply doing that which is right. Not only do you believe, but because you believe, you want to do that which is right in God's sight. Can I get a witness? If it means helping somebody, I want to help. I got a heart of Christ. Christ came doing good, preaching all over the country, going healing the sick and giving sight to the blind. I may not be able to give sight to the blind, but I can help somebody get them some eyeglasses. Can I get a witness? Glory! Glory! Faith and works go hand in hand. Show me somebody that has faith, and I'll show you somebody that has works also. Because they know that because I'm saved, I want to see someone else be saved. Therefore, being justified by faith, you have peace. I know I didn't, that's just a sample. I didn't even go into the works of the law that Paul discusses. I didn't go into the other works of righteousness. But the main thing I want you to know is if you are in Christ, you are got there by faith, and you are, and while you're there, you're continuing to do his work. Oh, yes, you are. That's why I'm closing this thing. That's why as the late Reverend J.L. Webster said, he said, Christians don't have a vacation. Yeah. But he said, the reward is out of this world. Yeah, we don't have, we don't get a Christian doesn't get a vacation. Yeah, not a real vacation. Because if you were to go on a vacation, so to speak, then there ought to be somebody you ought to meet for you to tell that Jesus is alive and well. But oh, we have a retirement that's out of this world. When you hear him say, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things. Come on, Brother Green. I'll make you ruler over many." Faith and works. Faith alone will save you. But saving faith is never alone. Brother Green gives us encourage you to test your faith by your works, and your test your works by your faith. Are you as committed? Are you as grounded in your faith? James believed in the physical appearance of faith. Yeah, the physical appearance. Works of righteousness are all physical. Let us stand. All of physical evidence. I think I put in your notes that faith or works is the product, but faith is the raw material. A beautiful home is the product, but it came from raw material of timber, concrete. Somebody had to take that raw material and make it into a beautiful home. Your raw material is the faith that's moving you, inside of you, and it ought to cause you to move in the way of the Lord, what the Lord wants you to do. Works of righteousness. If you're here and you have not accepted the Lord as your Savior, now's a good time to do so. All one has to do is believe that thou art the Christ, Son of the living God, and ask him into your life. Come into my life and be the Lord of my life. I give my life to thee. He'll do it. He'll save you. Then he'll turn you to want to do the works of righteousness. Great is your mercy. Yes. Your loving kindness. Oh Lord. Great, great, great. Great is your mercy. Glory. Amen. Let the house say amen. That the Lord is merciful in his grace. I hope and pray that take those notes and follow them. Take those scriptures and follow them. And let this grow within your heart. Amen. Thank God for each of you. Happy to see the carols as they are recuperating. Amen. And what a wonderful, wonderful blessing that is. During the course of the week, be in prayer for all of the things that are occurring around us. Amen. This, I know one of the churches is having, you may stand, having a 36-hour vigil. Church in Louisiana. A prayer for all of the people that would be impacted and by the hurricane. But let us just pray. You don't have to necessarily meet at a certain location or at a certain time, but let us not forget. For we are all our brother's keeper, regardless of whether we are two doors down or 1,000 miles away. Amen. Let us bow. Gracious Lord, thank you for these two divine doctrines and how they serve together to fulfill us with salvation and with works of righteousness. Now, Lord, watch and keep us. Be with us. And let us be with you. Unto him that's able to keep us from falling and render us faultless before his presence with exceeding joy. Unto the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, dominion, majesty, and power, henceforth, now, and forever. Let us all say together, Amen. God bless you. May God keep you, is our prayer. Have a great week. We'll see you in midweek service. The young people will be, we are starting our youth program. Amen. Brother Brian will be contacting you and tell the youth of your household that we'll be informing you of what the next step is, all right? Amen. Pray. Amen. God bless you. Okay.